Mara, thank you so much for the beautiful introduction, and Leslie and Mara for the invitation, and everyone for coming in times like this. So, and it's wonderful to be here and to come from California to the Twin Cities. And I miss Gareth and Keila. I thought I just should put that out there, since that's the first month after his retirement from the radio show. But anyhow, so I thought I'd talk with you about this project that I've been working on for a long while now, and not so much on the late antique texts, but on the current instantiations. I hope it's somewhat relevant to some of the issues that we face, and that we faced for a long time, but now maybe more urgently. And I invite then questions and engagements with this at the end. So let me share a few thoughts with you. So during the past two decades, or so, the Jewish practice referred to in shorthand as Eruv has been brought to the attention of a variety of public fora in the United States. In a few prominent cases, it has even been litigated in American courts, such as in the Tenafly case in New Jersey and the ongoing, now settled case, actually, in the Hamptons, West Hampton Beach. So briefly, by way of introduction, Eruv is a practice, and most of you know that, and more accurately, an installation ostensibly aiding the observance of Sabbath law as defined and discussed by traditional rabbinic law or halakha. As per strictures of Jewish law, observant Jews are prohibited on the Sabbath, among other things, to carry anything out of their houses, for instance, across the street to the synagogue, or into the neighbor's house. However, at the same time as prohibiting such behavior on the Sabbath, rabbinic law on the Shabbat, well, on the Sabbath, rabbinic law devised a set of practices, the Eruv, allowing observant Jews to circumvent this particular Sabbath prohibition under certain circumstances. In the modern context, and especially in larger urban context, this involves the installation of boundary marking structures where pre-existing boundary markers such as fences, walls, or creeks are not sufficient to operate as a boundary. It is this installation which, although relatively minor and relatively invisible and entirely permeable, and these things need to be emphasized because symbolic only, requires by ritual design or halachic design the Jewish community to go, what I want to call to go public. In the ancient text, the requirement is, right, the one that requires engagement with a non-Jewish community is to actually rent the public spaces which Jews share with non-Jews. And the symbolic rental contracts exist to this day in the installation of the Eruv. And on most shul sites, synagogue sites, you can, websites, there's copies of these rental contracts. In the contemporary controversies, right, and the Talmud sort of presumes that the non-Jews will never engage in that and thinks about the controversies between Jews and non-Jews around that issue. But in the contemporary controversies, these controversies arise because of the installation of the structures. These installations involve public, and in many cases, public utility companies, and the use of their installations in urban space. In as far as the installation of an Eruv involves the public and in certain ways lays claim to the public, this particular aspect of Jewish Sabbath observance therefore defies the consignment of religion to the private sphere, as is the goal of liberal democracies. That the installation of Eruvin in American urban context should become a matter of controversy, of public controversy, is by no means self-evident, as those who regard this as an issue for church-state legislation would have us believe. Urban Eruvin have been installed in many American cities without controversy since the 1970s. In fact, in some places like New York, they have existed for over a century. I did my homework, and there is an Erruf in St. Louis Heights also. St. Louis Park, sorry. Since 1990, which apparently went up with St. Yeah, bless you. So I'd be curious to hear about this also. So the reasons for the recent controversies ending up in litigation in American courts are therefore complex, not only the result of more or less willful misperceptions of what is actually involved and at stake with the installation of an Eruv. They have to do with local Jewish politics and civic politics, in some cases personalities, with changing demographies and the perception of or anticipation of such a change, and with deepening divisions among American Jews between liberal and Orthodox Jews. Finally, and perhaps most importantly for our purposes, such controversies constitute a contestation of religion and visible religiosity in public spaces. So in what follows, I will discuss the controversy in the Hamptons by first providing a brief description or an analysis of the case with some reference to other controversies, and then by discussing its implications for the larger issues of religion in the public sphere. The reason why I want to focus on that specific conflict is not so much because of the particulars in the case. In fact, the various controversies share quite a few aspects in common, the particularities of local politics notwithstanding. However, in this case, my own scholarly work on the origin and the cultural politics of the Eruv in the classical rabbinic literature of the first millennium has not only been called upon as providing testimony in the litigation, but became subject of conflicting interpretation in and of itself. History of religion became entangled with the practice of American law. It was so exciting that for once your scholarship becomes relevant, actually. So there's good reason to talk a little bit about this, and then the implications. I'll say I won't be involved. I stayed out of it in the end, and I could have earned my son's college money, but I decided not to. But you'll see why. So a few years ago, I was contacted by a law firm from New York, introducing themselves as largely representing a group of persons from diverse backgrounds, but largely Reform Jews, who are opposing the Eruv on constitutional establishment clause grounds. So the lawyer said to me, your name has been given to us as a leading scholar in this area and a brief, so I'm not only working on menstrual purity, but also in this particular area, and a brief review of your impressive CV confirms as much. I'm reading this with ironic whatever. We are interested in an academic perspective on the issue, both to better educate ourselves about it, but also for the purpose of steering clear of some of the understandably emotional or political responses that tend to arise when it is approached from a purely religious angle, meaning when a rabbi is brought in. In that regard, the litigation is likewise focused on the purely constitutional legal questions and is not in any way attempting to advance an anti-Orthodox sentiment. Mm-hmm. Quote end. I was intrigued, of course, in the sudden interest in my academic work in classical rabbinic legal literature by contemporary law. It did not take a lot of research to figure out that the Eruv controversy that this lawyer alluded to was one that had caught the attention of the wider public, not only in newspaper reports, as was the case in many other controversies. Rather, this particular one had acquired some notoriety by being featured on Jon Stewart's The Daily Show. And I wanted to show it tonight, but then we didn't have time to put it. But it's on YouTube in an interview segment by Wyatt Cenac, The Thin Jew Line. You can Google it under the thin Jew line, and it's one of the most brilliant discussions, actually, of the issue, and they're very funny. The evolving litigation of the case is well documented in the public sphere at the municipal website of the village of West Hampton Beach, which presents a collection of the relevant court documents. The background of the controversy and evolution of the litigation can only be told in brief here, and I'll summarize some of that. As a scholar of classic Jewish law and literature, also known as rabbinic law, I tried to remain impartial to the litigation and actually didn't get involved in the end. But as a historian of religion, I considered this controversy as one particular instantiation of the long history of social dynamics between Jews in all their variety and between Jews and non-Jews, that the ritual of the Eruv has, the ritual institution of the Eruv has rendered and continues to render visible. And so that's the element I want to foreground and emphasize. In as much as we can think about the Eruv as a form of going public for Jewish observance of traditional Jewish law, I want to consider the relevance of the West Hampton Beach controversy to our thinking about the mapping of religion onto public and private, on the public and private divide underwriting liberal democracy. So in March 2008, when the Modern Orthodox Synagogue, and you will recognize these patterns from some of the disputes that you know, but when the Modern Orthodox Synagogue in West Hampton Beach was about to celebrate its 18th birth anniversary in that village, the community proposed the installation of the Eruv. To that end, the executive director of the community obtained a license agreement with the public utility companies, in this case, the Long Island Power Authority, to make use of some of their utility poles and lines, where pre-existing markers in the natural and built environment did not provide a contiguous boundary. A map of the boundaries for the Eruv proposed in 2008 is readily available online. For the purpose of an Eruv installation, use of the utility poles and telephone lines entails minimal manipulation of the public sphere, namely by the utility companies themselves affixing plastic strips on the poles. In rabbinic law, these plastic strips are referred to as lechis, or side posts for what is to constitute symbolic gateways into the neighborhood. In terms of rabbinic law, going back to its founding legal text of the second century, the Mishnah, and its interpretations and adaptations thereafter, such plastic strips constitute a modern symbolic emulation of what in the late ancient urban environment were thought of as gateways to a contained residential space, such as the walled courtyard or the alleyways. However, in the encounter between rabbinic law and the contemporary US legal system, it is a symbolic valence of these plastic strips that are part of the litigation, as I will discuss in a second. So I keep emphasizing it's the in the rabbinic thinking, it's supposed to represent gateways rather than walls, because that comes up all the time, that what the thing does is to represent walls and fences. And how we decode the symbolism and the symbolic valence will play a huge role in the rhetorical, right, the emotional that break into the open over this. So as the Orthodox community of West Hampton Beach came forward with a proposal for the installation of an Eruv, criticism of the project started to foment, even though the Orthodox rabbi employed the classic modern arguments in defense of the Eruv, namely the Eruv, quote, will enable families to push small children in strollers or baby carriages when they go to services on the Sabbath. What Eruv proponent would not want to appeal to the basic American sense of gender? Well, I wrote this a couple of weeks ago. To the basic American sense of gender equity and basic concern for the disabled, in order to convince non-Jewish authorities, of the beneficial effects of the Eruv. In response to the proposal, opponents of the Eruv established themselves as a group known as the Jewish People Opposed to the Eruv, the JPOE, with their own website detailing the controversy and their take on it. It bears emphasizing that this group represents itself quite explicitly and strategically as Jewish. Arguably, this aided their strategy of casting the conflict as an intra-Jewish conflict, especially in legal terms. As we'll see, and this is then how the law firm that contacted me in the email cited above represented its clients, right, as mostly Reformed Jews. In the Tenafly controversy, as in our own Palo Alto controversy, Jews of a variety of liberal, religious, and political and secular backgrounds provided prominent voices in the opposition, but the opposition did not represent itself as primarily Jewish. This is actually how I got initially into the whole project, because when I came to Stanford, there was a big public controversy over the installation of the Eruv there, and the Orthodox rabbi had misjudged the willingness of the community to accommodate such an installation. I mean, eventually it went up, and there is an Eruv now, but it no longer involved the city council, so he went around the that public arena. So after initial failure of the Eruv proposal in the West Hampton controversy, its proponents eventually incorporated themselves as the East End Eruv Association, the proponents. The forming of Eruv associations as the entity to carry forth the installation and to be responsible for the maintenance of the installation has, of course, been the practice of almost every other urban Eruv proposal. So in May 2010, the proponents entered an agreement with another utility company to make use of their utility poles for the purposes of the installation and so on. From there on, the social dynamics in the village, I mean, of West Hampton Beach, I've actually never been there now that I think about it, but between what had now solidified into two opposing camps deteriorated to the degree that the village hired an attorney. And the proponents, the EEA, had it interned by an attorney who has also happened to be the founding member of the Hampton Synagogue. So the proponents filed a lawsuit in federal court against the village in 2011, and that lawsuit suggested that the actions of the defendants, the opponents, constitute an intentional deprivation and interference with plaintiffs' rights under the United States Constitution and statutes, and private contracts entered between the EEA and independent third parties, namely the utility companies. That is, the proponents laid claims to the free exercise clause of the First Amendment, and this is also the time when The Daily Show became interested in the controversy for its comedic purposes and aired its now famous version of it. You just have to, tonight, for some comic relief, look for this on Google if you can. But from that point forward, both camps have remained in litigation. Only this year, actually, I think at the beginning of the year, settled. In my conversations with legal counsel on both sides, both have different versions of who is to blame for the escalation. And then I did not see myself in a position to get involved. My main interest, to emphasize again, is understanding the implications of the publicness of the Eruv as an institution to our thinking about the place of religion in the public sphere. So before I summarize the rest, I will just say that so first the ostensibly Reformed group hired me. I ended up saying no to them. And then 3 months later, the other side came to me and said, this is strange. Never was academic work so involved in legal opinions. Who are you? And so then they tried to hire me to sign that the other side presented a misreading of my work in court. Can you sign? And then I talked with friends in the law school, and they said, well, but it ended up signing. But Will can talk a little bit more. Anyhow, so then in March 2013, the opponents and its attorney made a request to the public utilities to terminate that agreement, went to court to United States District Courts, and their claim was, just to cite that, indeed, it will invest a large portion, the Eruv will invest a large portion of the village with a narrow and parochial religious function and thus constitute a violation of the Establishment Clause. So the opponents relied, just like the proponents, on First Amendment law in its federal complaint in 2011. But while the proponents took course to the Free Exercise Clause, the JPOE, the opponents, turned to the Establishment Clause. So I received the email cited above 2 weeks after the opponents filed lawsuit. One component of the Establishment Clause argument concerns the nature of the plastic strips, and that we can have a discussion about, to be affixed to the public utility poles, and whether indeed these are to be regarded as a religious symbol. Right, their argument really hinged on, is this a religious symbol, like the cross? As the plaintiffs argued, the plastic strips constitute, quote, a constant and ever-present symbol, message, and reminder to the community at large that the secular public spaces of the village have been transformed for religious use and identity. They are, quote, a symbol of the Orthodox community's particular kind of observance permanently affixed to and openly displayed on public property. If so, the argument goes, the lechis have to be perceived as religious symbols. The village's permission to use property to the religious community could constitute endorsement of a particular religious community and would therefore violate the Establishment Clause. However, part of the endorsement, I made myself a little bit smart on these issues, but many of you probably understand this better. But however, part of the endorsement test introduced by Justice O'Connor into religion clause jurisprudence requires that, quote, irrespective of governmental purpose, the reasonable and objective observer determines whether governmental action has the effect of endorsing religion. Because there has been, of course, a lot of discussion about what the heck a reasonable and objective observer is and whether there ever is such a set a person to perceive whether government action has the effect of endorsing religion. And so a lot of that's the criticism of Justice O'Connor's amendment there. So just a few thoughts on public visibility of religious difference as legal argument. So this is where the dispute over the visibility of the Eruv installment becomes important. The factor of visibility is at the center of almost every recent Eruv controversy in a variety of forms and shapes, and not only regarding the visibility of the lechis or poles and fishing lines themselves, which is also the case in the West Hampton Beach. Just to remind you, they said the Eruv, of course, will not go unnoticed. Rather, it will be a constant and ever-present symbol, message, and reminder to the community at large that the secular public space of the village have been transformed for religious use. Always an emphasis, of course, you know, once the Eruv is up and the controversy blows over, no one has any clue where this thing is, and it totally recedes into invisibility. But they emphasize that, quote, indeed, the whole point of the Eruv for those who observe it is to openly and visibly demarcate a certain geographic area as a Jewish precinct that is a symbolic extension of a Jewish home. The dispute over the symbolic nature of the Eruv installation and the visibility of the Eruv installation is not unique to West Hampton, although both the Tenafly conflict and the long 15-year-long controversy in North London focused on different aspects of visibility, namely the change in the appearance of the neighborhood, with supposedly more Orthodox Jews moving to town. Arguably, it would be easy enough to counter the argument over the visibility of the plastic strips on the utility poles, the lechis themselves, which is what the Daily Show did. That is, unless one knows that the Eruv installation exists, a non-informed or reasonable and objective observer will not notice it and most certainly not be able to decipher its function or meaning. The way that, right, the lawyers ask me, is it a symbolic system like the cross? I'm like, you're the constitutional lawyer, you have to make the case. But even the informed observer who emerges from a long, drawn-out controversy, such as the one in Palo Alto, Tenafly, or London, will not be confronted by it or otherwise have his or her field of vision intruded upon in any significant way as an ever-present symbol. This applies even to those cases where where there are no pre-existing utility poles and lines that can be used, and where therefore the additional poles with the fishing lines have to put off. As far as I know, no study exists to prove this point. If one were to stop the hundreds and perhaps thousands of cars that cross each day under the fishing line, spanning one of the major roads leading into the city of Palo Alto, Pagemo, and ask the drivers whether they had noticed this, the fishing line or the post on either side of the road supporting it, there is simply no doubt that not a single one of the drivers. Well, see, you would have to do the, I mean, I discussed this case with my students one in case, and they were amazed that this was at the entrance of Palo Alto, once you pointed out, right? But so the same would be true even more so for the lechis on the pre-existing poles, arguably. In that regard, these components of the Eruv installation defy the semantic purpose of what makes a religious symbol a symbol, and a religious one at that, to a reasonable and objective observer. They are barely noticeable and do not bear any inherent significance or message. They are not readable in the way a cross is readable to the public, or the way even a menorah or a creche is readable, because they signify something in of these signify something in and of themselves. Compared to church, synagogue, and mosque buildings and their minarets and steeples, the Eruv constitutes a minimalist intervention in and manipulation of the built environment. Thus, the lechis, that's the, my argument, so, but that, right, you could engage or contest. Thus, the lechis mean nothing other than to those who rely on them as to their Sabbath observant. Arguably, however, it might be beyond the court's jurisprudence to figure out what is that, what it is that constitutes a quote-unquote religious symbol. So now a few, just a few remarks on the intra-Jewish sectarianism as a legal argument. The second component of the complaint, however, is unique so far to the West Hampton Beach controversy, at least in its overt nature. The JPOE, the opponents, complaints, their complaint seeks to cast the Eruv installation as a sectarian Jewish project, and this is where the incorporation of the opposition becomes relevant. The document spells out, quote, many Jews reject the very concept of an Eruv and sincerely believe that the particular form of Jewish belief and observant that elevates such legalistic constructs over the true spiritual values of Judaism and the Sabbath is abhorrent to their own religious views and interpretation of Jewish law. Quote end. This is an absolutely amazing move for a legal argument, since now the lawyer, that was what the lawyers argued, lay claim to an authentic, or as I say, true understanding of Judaism. The spiritual, right, the true spiritual nature of the Sabbath. They are taking recourse to a supposedly authoritative decision issued by the Rabbinic Umbrella Organization of Reform Judaism, the Central Conference of American Rabbis. The lawyers read the CCAR's recommendation to have rejected the Eruv outright. Quote from their opinion, indeed, it is the official opinion of the Central Conference of American Rabbis that an Eruv is a sort of legal fiction which is inconsistent with the true spirit of Jewish law, quote end. In other words, the dispute is now cast as one over the correct interpretation of Sabbath law and its observance, rather than as one over divergent versions of Judaism. The village's permission for the Eruv installation would therefore constitute an establishment clause infraction, as government would give preference to one side of an intra-religious dispute, or could be, quote, reasonably seen and understood by them, the opponents, as endorsing particular religious beliefs and practices, proponents, as endorsing particular religious beliefs and practices that they do not hold or which they affirmatively oppose. This is where my work on the Eruv in late antiquity with the rabbis and the Talmud came to play some role. Two arguments that I advanced in my reading of the classical rabbinic law in its historical context came to play a role in legal argumentation. First, I have argued in print, I mean, I don't like quoting myself, but understand the argument, I'll do this, I'm not quoting it, just summarizing. I have argued in print that the invention of the Eruv in early rabbinic law in the Mishnah could in that context be considered sectarian for the following reasons. We have strong textual evidence that a variety of Jewish groups, such as witnessed in the Dead Sea Scrolls and the Book of Jubilees preceding the rabbinic text, observed the prohibition of carrying objects out of the house, tent, or an otherwise private residence as one of the Sabbath prohibitions. So that practice of, or the prohibition of carrying something goes back to actually supposedly to Jeremiah and the Book of Nehemiah, but it goes across all these Jewish sectarian groups and is reflected in that literature. So the rabbis inherit that when they make Mishnah law. The rabbis, however, were the only ones to devise the Eruv as a mechanism to allow Jews to do just that on the Sabbath. Right, and that initially also got me as a rabbinicist into that, that you have, when you study the Mishnah, on the one hand, a long tractate on Sabbath law and very detailed prohibitions of what you can carry, not carry. And then the next tractate right after it, and by the way, ha ha, here's what you do to get around this entire thing that you just spend many months studying. So that is sort of that quintessential rabbinic moment. I mean, it's not so ha-ha, but it requires a deep reflection. But the point on, one other detour is, there's a little book by Alan Dundee, The Sabbath Elevator and Other Ways of Circumventing Jewish Law and Character. And he is was a folklorist in at the University of Berkeley, grew up Orthodox and then fell from grace with the Holy One and blessing. And his work was mostly on German jokes and German obsessions in reflected in jokes. But that book is about these things, and he also discusses the Eruv there. It turns a little mean at the end, but. It's very interesting, so but the point of considering the rabbinic legal strategy as in some way sectarian within the ancient Jewish landscape was to read the rabbinic strategies of casting the innovations of its own lawmaking and legal interpretation of biblical law for what they were, namely strategies of persuading followers of the authoritativeness of their own legal authority. The contemporary Jewish landscape in the United States is a somewhat different landscape compared to the late ancient, not least of all because by now the discourse and practice of the Eruv has been around for almost 2 millennia of Jewish cultural history. Therefore, it is difficult to construe the Eruv as a misinterpretation of Jewish Sabbath law, as the lawyers did, even though the biblical Sabbath law does not contain much of that would suggest such a construct. Nor does it make much sense to consider the Eruv sectarian unless one considered rabbinic law, halacha, altogether as sectarian form of Judaism. So right, that's an argument to sort of where I had to think through, is it really a misreading of my work if they apply what I argued for the late ancient context to the contemporary, context in the United States. Second, another argument I made in my reading of the classic rabbinic text, and one that I hold by, is that the institution of the Eruv served the early rabbis as a mechanism to draw a distinction between insiders and outsiders. So that's a classic anthropological reading of some of these ritual practices, between those that belong and those that are beyond the purview of the strictures of rabbinic law. Over the course of history, that distinction in general has taken on various valences depending on historical circumstances. And certainly at times, rabbinic scholars did not look upon those beyond their purview with generosity and grace, to put it kindly. In certain contexts, whether that was because they were under pressure themselves and whatnot, but this the rabbis share with numerous other groups that define their identity by a variety of practices of belonging. The Eruv is just one such strategy to draw a boundary between insider and outsider, in this case by way of spatial practice. The lawyer for the JPOE, for the opponents, no names named, seized upon his historical anthropological argument on this argument to underline the exclusionary mechanism of the Eruv. Quote, it is a symbol that communicates a deliberately divisive and indeed exclusionary message, at least as understood within the larger community. This divisive and exclusionary meaning has been insightfully described by Professor Charlotte Elisheva von Robert. I'm like, what? In some ways, this amounts to contesting in court that the Catholic Church excludes Protestants from its sacraments. That is to say, of course, the project of defining a collective identity is to define boundaries between those who belong and those who do not, those who define themselves in those terms and those who do not. The special force of the Eruv, especially in its contemporary urban landscape, is to do so by installing what are perceived physical boundary markers in the urban landscape, thus by drawing on geography to underwrite collective identity. This lawyer is not the only one who simply equates the late ancient rabbis and their opponents with contemporary modern Orthodox Jews and Reform and other liberal Jews or non-Jews. This happens in other controversies too. However, the path from the ancient past to the contemporary Jewish scene in urban America is not a straight path. And clearly, exclusion in terms of self-distinction from others is not simply the same as exclusion as a political tool of majorities with respect to minorities. So to conclude, the practice of Eruv presents us with a particular form of religious claim to the public or publicness. And for that reason has seemed to so many to pose a challenge to First Amendment jurisdiction. Those involved in the recent controversies, as the one discussed above, argue in terms of First Amendment strictures and protection, whether by calling upon the Establishment Clause or the Free Exercise Clause. Anthropologists and ethnographers, as well as historians of religions, draw on different explanations to explain the potentiality for controversy built into the Eruv installation. I want to emphasize one aspect of the Eruv installation that escapes any firm grasp of the challenge that it really poses. That is, what kind of claim to the public the Eruv really poses. We have seen that visibility plays a role in the argumentation, yet the Eruv installation is barely visible. Outright denial of visibility, however, does not help either with the resolution of the recent disputes. Since from the days of the Mishnah onwards, rabbinic law does in fact require a manipulation, however minimal it is, but it requires a manipulation of the urban environment. The fact that classical rabbinic law did not conceive of any conflict regarding the manipulation of the urban environment as they conceived of it is telling with regard to the contemporary context. Right. So I spent a lot of time studying these texts, and the rabbinic texts themselves never reflect that anyone would have a problem with them putting up these lechis in the urban, or actually more richer symbolic gale in the urban environment. And that tells you something about the difference, right, who gets to act in the in urban space. So for them, the conflict scene was really only that rental contract with the authorities. As pointed out above, in the ancient context, they only considered manipulation of the entrance to a shared space because containing and contiguous walls pre-existed in the late ancient urban environment and were not considered an interference with one's daily life. In the contemporary context, the installation of symbolic gateways has to signify that there are also symbolic walls somewhere in the urban landscape, the rivers and the pre-existing fences and whatnot, even if they are entirely symbolic and intangible, such as in the form of a creek that forms part of the boundary. I also studied and I want to put that in here as a footnote, documentation of, actually there's various, in Germany in the 18th and 19th century, in many of the archives now, there's documentation of rabbinic authorities going to the Prussian authorities and whatever, trying to explain what the Eruv is, and then and trying to convince them to allow them to put up some symbolic markers. And it's a very rich resource, because here you have rabbis trying to explain to very hostile magistrates what they're doing. And it's a powerful moment in German history, because that's a moment in where the city walls all come down. Right, in the 18th, 19th century, they raise the city walls, and that's where Jewish communities then lose the pre-existing boundaries that allowed them to circumvent having to deal with non-Jewish authorities. And there's couple of very interesting archival sort of stories. Nonetheless, the very fact that now an Eruv installation takes the form of inscriptions on maps on the internet, readily accessible online, clearly provides conceptual fodder for the perception that the Jewish community is laying claim to a geographical area of town. If you can click, right, it would be nice to sort of make these maps all across the United States where there are these Eruvin. Drawing maps of urban areas based on religious identity and practice is a form of laying claim to public space, however symbolic that may be. The fact that no one can see the plastic strips becomes totally insignificant in light of, you just have to click on the map. Actually in Palo Alto, the synagogue did not put up its map because they're worried that, right, there was so much opposition, so there's no map of the Eruv on the internet. The symbolic nature of the Eruv is what requires public negotiation in order to explain such maps. And here I want to conclude with what I still consider the radical and subversive nature of the Eruv, in spite of all the anxiety it has created in the recent conflicts. The Eruv imposes a layer of meaning onto an urban map that is anchored minimally in the physical urban landscape. As a layer of meaning, it creates a new form of public, one that makes the urban environment legible in terms of ancient Jewish law, but in such a way that it would allow for any other form of public to be part of it. An Eruv may include a church parish, for instance, as it most certainly does in the case of larger urban Eruvin. You may think of Los Angeles, that is around the entire West LA. Mm-hmm. Of course, there are churches within there, so you have different kinds of like church parishes in there. And thus includes a form of public that the parish establishes. It may include the White House or the European Parliament, and thus the most public form of public imaginable. It does in Washington, actually. In such cases, the Eruv adds a dimension rather than shielding or suppressing another. It defies all forms of isomorphism that require an equation between collective identity and physical environment. And it is this dimension that has yet to play out its full potential. Thank you.
Thank you, Charlotte, for an absolutely wonderful talk. I'm sure there will be many questions, so I'd like to open it up for discussion, and if you want to just field your own comments, questions.
So what was the decision in the Hamptons?
In the Hamptons, I have to do better homework on that, but they settled out of court in January. So the city, the village, one first Southampton, then and then I can't pronounce the next one, Kogi, one of those villages. And then the last one was to settle was West Hampton Beach, because the legal costs got so prohibitive, so that they said enough already. This has been since 2008, so it went over 8 years to going back and forth. So they settled it.
Did they settle it by keeping the area?
By keeping, yeah. So, I don't see, that's where not a lawyer enough, but no case in the courts has yet won against the free exercise, right? Because the Orthodox communities will always say, you are preventing us from doing what we need to do. So some people will argue there's no way that this can ever win. But the other side will say, right, they're waiting for a case that can make it to the Supreme Court. Which, who knows? I mean, it would be I mean, given the other urgent cases that we have, it may be not the most the most pressing issue, right? But yeah, no.
Yeah, that brings up a question that I had about the. I mean, I my own personal sympathies aside, something that strikes me about the Eruv is that it's precisely not necessary for the exercise of Jewish life in the way that kosher food, I mean, if you don't eat, you're going to die. But you can live without having an Eruv. It's more inconvenient. You have to, you know, you can't push a stroller, but it's possible to live in places without an Eruv. So how, you know, is there, you know, what's happening?
No,
it's not like food in the same way, right? Like an Eruv is not, it's not, I don't know. It's not necessary. I don't know, maybe it is. Is an Eruv necessary for Jewish life?
Well, it depends on where you're living. It depends on how you live.
No, I'm trying to, right, I take the notes so I can think it through. I mean, point well taken, but you could raise that on a, right, now of course I have to think through how you would argue the case legally, but internally Jewish, you could say, I can make it through Shabbos without turning on and off the light or making a fire unless you live in Poland, then it might be or wherever in the north, or in Minnesota. I'm still thinking California. We can make it through the winter without heat, but right. But that's why the argument of this, right, and that is a powerful argument in the court. So you enable wheelchairs and how do you call them? Now forgot.
Strollers.
Thank you. Strollers to make it to school. I mean, I don't like that argument. I find it a little bit cheesy always because it assumes that women, just because of strollers, cannot go to shul, right? So, but yeah. So, so true. I don't have a good. I mean, I have to think it through in terms of constitutional law. I haven't quite perfected that ability yet. But right, they could use that, but. You want to say, my answer to think it through loud would be to say, well, you have to help it out. That, of course, we don't need it, but it enhances Jewish communal life, and that's so not convincing in the courts, but maybe. You know. I mean, it has been convincing anyhow.
Clearly.
So yeah.
It seems like a lot of the civil rights issues here historically have had to do with expansion of rights rather than restriction of. And it seems to me that with the Arab controversy, we're talking about expanding rights. It's not, even if you want to say it's an establishment of religion, if somebody doesn't believe in it or care, is not Jewish or not Orthodox, it's not making them have to do something, and it's not keeping them from doing anything. It's enabling other people who feel this is important to be able to have access. So it's kind of hard to understand why that would be an establishment of religion when it's not requiring anyone to do anything.
Right. I mean, I think their point with this was, right, if the reform, right, let's say their argument is actually not quite accurate, but if Reform Judaism really actually refuses, I mean, not only refuses, but says that is a wrong interpretation of Sabbath law because of the Sabbath, because we go by the true spirit of the Sabbath, right? So then in that intra-religious controversy, government sides with the Orthodox community, if they allow them to put it up, against the Reform Jewish community, and then it falls under establishment because, right, you help them more than the others, and that's how they argued the case. So then I checked into that, right? So there is I forgot the precise date, but the Reform movement has they call their rabbinic opinions also responsa, right? So they go still by the process of making, articulating norms, not halacha, but norms in terms of responsa and these collections, right? And then the CCAR collects them. And so this one was from, and I have it somewhere, but in, I think in the early 80s by a rabbi that I don't know the names, that he really says, very short, and it's actually not really a very developed argument or opinion, it's just very short that it has something to its effect in there, right, that this Eruv business is the wrong interpretation, something in what they quote there, in line with the true spirit of the Sabbath. So then I talked with Warshavsky and the current, right, the people in charge of the collections. He says that's one of these responsa that they had, right, big trouble with because it no longer reflects actually, it absolutely doesn't reflect current reform thinking. So they have to actually sort of come out with another one, but I don't think they have yet. So therefore, the establishment, if you argue the establishment clause, if they argue the establishment clause this way, it doesn't hold anyway because, right, it's not reform, it's not in, in any significant way reform against Orthodox because it's not against reform Judaism in any kind of way. Right, so, yeah.
Okay, I'm not Jewish, so I may say something dumb, but...
No, nothing.
No.
I guess...
Like this one.
My understanding of the First Amendment is, you know, the balance between free exercise and establishment clause is the courts and the government are not supposed to get entangled with religion, and the other side seemed to be telling the court, you have to interpret religious decisions and try to figure them out, which seems to be the where the point where the court should say, I'm out of here. Yeah. we're not going to construe Jewish law.
Right, so right.
That's what puzzles me about the arguments that the other side was making.
Right, so I mean, technically you're right. So the courts agree because they right, that argument never went. And that's why the JPOE, I mean, the opponents there never made it in courts and then eventually settled. It was always sort of going on, trying different routes, but I mean, so they would agree with you, right? Because it makes no, I mean, it absolutely, makes no sense.
It makes sense from the very beginning.
Right, unless you can really say, right, you're, if you give them this, the other ones will lose out, which they can't, right? So that's not going to hold, so.
Susan and then Jonathan. Just a point of information, in June of this year, they expanded the West Hampton Eruv. It now includes West Hampton Beach and Quogue, part of Quogue Village and part of West Hampton. Now they're asking to expand to Southampton. That'll be good. Wait till they hit
over
East Hampton. Wait till they hit East Hampton. Oh, yeah, wait, that's going to happen. But it seems that the courts are stepping back from intervening in that particular fight, which just seems to be the smarter thing to do. Do they still believe that an Eruv fight can go to the Supreme Court?
Well, they are, I mean, this guy, in this case, I did. Right, they thought they, I mean, they communicated that, but I can't
see it getting past, you know, any sort of appellate procedure because it really, it doesn't impact anybody
right.
But the people that observe
right,
it.
Right, 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 right,
well,
right. I mean,
there's
yeah, wait a minute, I wanted to know, I forgot what I wanted to say there. No, I that seems to be right there. The sense of that, but shoots, no, this escapes me. I had a brilliant point, but it was so brilliant that, no.
Actually, Marvin, did you want to weigh in on this?
Isn't there a case in New York at the present time where the Reform want to establish an Eruv, and it's being opposed by the Orthodox, saying we are, there already is an error.
But it's not.
And
I haven't.
Yes, I believe it's a bond.
I have to. I don't know about that. That would be totally brilliant. I have to. Right. I mean, you have actually. There's a number of controversies intra-Orthodox, right? Because some of it is also turns into, and that has nothing to do with American law litigation. That's more about. And that sort of could be, if that's true, that's a version there of that. The establishment of Eruv is for your community, right? So where is that? I think somewhere in Williamsburg they had the issues between two different Jewish groups. Do I recognize the authority of Rabbi so-and-so established that? His Eruv is not my Eruv, and then you get into, right? So then it has to do with authoritative. Right, so right, you could have perceivably like the layering of a number of different Eruv maps on top of each other. Yeah.
We have plastic strips everywhere.
Yeah. Color code.
And
you forgot. Emma.
I'm curious if there are other religious symbols that you've explored that interact with geography in any ways parallel to the Eruv.
Ah. Yeah, I mean, not yet in a coherent kind of way, and that's obviously sort of, once I have more time to think, actually, to want to do that. I mean, the way, the direction that I've thought about that is, and that doesn't work, but it's sort of, right, that's around the invisibility issues with religious buildings. That, I mean, that some of the controversies, and that's where I sort of thought through the connection of that with, for instance, let's say the building of the, sort of more monumental mosques now in Berlin. The newer development in Berlin of is, you know, as the Islamic communities become more established, and now there's a couple, I think four or five larger mosques going up, and there's a lot of geschrei over, and that's all over Europe, about the height of the minaret, right? Does that mess with the, and there was a famous case in Cologne also, does that mess with the, with the skyline of the city, right? And if that becomes, if there is a minaret next to the cathedral in Cologne, which is under UNESCO, under UNESCO protection, then what does that mean to the character of the city? Which is, in that case, was also a little bit ridiculous because Cologne, in the meantime, has lots of skyscrapers that are much higher, right? But so that's sort of one with, right, it doesn't obviously. And then the other thing was, and this is sort of not any good, it's like rainbow flags around the mission district. That's a way to sort of, right, mark the neighborhood also in a way that lends it right, here's a character, makes the identity of the neighborhood visible in some kind of way, but without being therefore exclusionary as to, right, whoever wants to move into the neighborhood. But it takes a little bit more. If you have any, what else to think with it would be great. So.
Yeah,